Please pray with me. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable and pleasing to you, our Lord, our Rock, our Redeemer. Amen. We're so glad that you guys are with us, especially in this week of National School Week, as we prepare and we spend time celebrating our school and everything that goes on there. Today, I picked one of my favorite stories growing up, the story of Jonah. I'm guessing at least everybody in here has at least heard of Jonah once, right? Good. I remember growing up very little. It was one of those stories that everybody wanted to read because everybody liked seeing Jonah get eaten by the... Okay, so there's whale and fish. Tells me what group you were. Older group, you're a whale. Newer group, we're fish, right? This is one of my favorite stories. It really became a great story for me. I remember in college, in undergrad, I was taking Hebrew. This was the first book I got to translate word for word. And there were a lot of things I didn't really know. And we're going to look at one of the parts. Most of us know chapters 1, 2, and 3. Did you know there's a chapter 4? You know, we all know the story, right? God comes to Jonah and he says, hey, I want you to go over to Nineveh. And Jonah goes, no, I don't want to go over there. Right? I don't want to be a part of that. To Jonah and his people, Nineveh was like going maybe the Middle East, going over about North Korea. Hey, I want you to go to North Korea. Why don't you go over there and tell them what they're doing wrong? Would you go? No. So Jonah gets on a boat and he starts going completely opposite direction. He actually goes to the city that's the farthest away from Nineveh possible of the land that they know. And then there's this great storm. They toss him over. He gets eaten. He gets spit up. He goes and tells everybody in the city. They all repent. And that's where our storybooks end. At least that's where it did when I was a kid, right? We just heard chapter 4. We heard Jonah's almost having a little pity party, right? He's upset that God is not going to do what to the Ninevites? Right. He wants them to what? He wants to destroy them. Yeah, good. He wants to destroy them. Tell you what. Hold on. Uh-oh. See if it'll clear it for me. There we go. Okay, open up your Bibles. Go on. If you got an app, you can open it up. Yeah. Page 775, chapter 4. All right, let's just look at that verse 1 and 2. We're not going to read all of it again. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he was angry. He's angry that God is going to show mercy to these foreigners who are terrible people. Right? And he prayed to the Lord and said, O Lord, is it not this what I said when I was still in my country? That is why I made haste to flee to Tarshish, for I knew that you were gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and relenting from disaster. You know, he knows God is going to be merciful, and he doesn't want it. Right? Today, We're still continuing the sermon series of goodness. Right? And obviously Jonah does not show very much goodness here, right? He's not showing any care. As I was looking at this word in the Greek, this comes from our Galatians reading. Anybody can read on the left? Pastor Tyner? Good. He's just shaking his head. He's not going to tell me, right? Partes, yes. As I looked this up in the dictionary, this comes out as goodness. This is the word we're using for goodness. It had an interesting definition. The quality of not being overly impressed by one's sense of one's self-importance. That's goodness. It's not looking at ourselves, but looking at others. Jonah is clearly looking at himself. He doesn't care about all these Ninevites. He doesn't really care about them. It's more about him than it is about them. You know, this is a man of God. This is a prophet of God, and he's not showing this. Don't we do the same thing? I mean, we're more worried about ourselves than we are about others. Don't we hold grudges? Oh, man, I was so right. That person was so wrong. I'm going to hold it against them for, well, and you're 20 years down the road, right? Or perhaps, you got somebody working with you, and you're like, this person's not cutting. I'm going to go get rid of them. I'm going to go tell the boss of all the things he's doing wrong instead of just spending some time and helping them. Or how often at least as a kid growing up, I would go tattle on all my brothers. You know, I didn't really care about that. I really wanted him to get in trouble so that I could start playing with the toy, right? Yeah. We love to be self-absorbed, right? We love to care more about us than we care about the people around us. This word goodness completely shows a different view. It's where we take our eyes off ourselves and we look out into the world and into our community and we show them compassion and love. You know, for Jonah, if he wanted to show this in self-importance, if he wanted to show goodness to others, maybe he needed to go and, well, as soon as God said, hey, why don't you go to Nineveh, he should have been jumping up and down, ready to go. Or when he gets there and they repent, oh, thank God they repented. He should be in the streets partying with them. But he goes up to the hill and has a pity party. It's the best I can say, right? He's more worried about this poor plant. He's more worried about everything else. He just wants to see something blow up. Yeah, I think it hits us hardest looking at this last verse in verse 10. It says, and the Lord said, you pity the plant for which you did not labor, nor did you make it grow, which came into being in the night and perished in the night. And should I not, and this is God speaking, I pity Nineveh, the great city in which there were more than 120,000 persons who do not know, and this is right hand, left hand, I don't know right from wrong, and there's also a lot of cattle that have no idea. Shouldn't God pity them? The reality is, we can't be good. We struggle with it, right? The only thing we can do is reflect a God who truly is goodness. Jonah knew that that God was good. He was going to relent. He was going to forgive. He knew all this. And yet we reflect that into our world. We reflect God's goodness in us to others. See, we share goodness to others when we, you know, take care of our neighbor. We see them struggling. Maybe it's fence work or mowing, or maybe they just need an extra hand and we go and help them. Or maybe it's the mom who stays up all night even though they got to work in the morning because their child is sick, and they're showing that child the love and mercy. Or maybe it's the dad who comes home early, putting aside some of the chores and the things of work, and goes out and plays catch with their son or their daughter. How about it's letting go of some of those grudges that we hold on to for so many years? It's forgiving and not wanting destruction. It's us caring for those around us. It's by showing God's mercy and His love. In our school this year, there's a theme for our chapels. And that theme is, it's all about Jesus. And we've been looking at the individual characteristics of Jesus. And one of the most important characteristics of Jesus is we see that He is truly good. I mean, think about it. He shows care for you like nobody else has ever done. He knew that we were like the Ninevites, struggling, and He comes and He lays down His life for you. He shows you mercy. He shows you care. He shows you compassion. That's the goodness of the world. It's in Christ. And this gift of the Spirit, something that lives in us, we get to share it to the world. Goodness. What would happen if there was a little bit more goodness out in that world? Would it change things? I think so. Today there's so much hate, so much destruction, so much frustrations out there. But what it needs is Jesus. It needs goodness. It needs us showing this world God's true love for them. And that's in Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Goodness in us because of Jesus Christ. Amen. Now may the grace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus until He comes again.